It's good to be in worship with you this morning. Stand to your feet. I don't know about you, but we came off of District Advance, some of us in the leadership, and wow, what a powerful weekend we had. But one of their messages, I'm going to take Pastor Barb's one-word thing that she gets from the Lord all the time. I was speaking to a friend over here. A lot of times we send encouraging messages to each other and videos and stuff. Do you ever do that? Do you just encourage another Christian friend by sending them something that God reveals to you? Anyways, we were speaking with one another, and I said, you know what? We need to get back to our heart breaking for what breaks God's hearts. Those were my exact words to her. Our heart needs a break for what breaks His. We need the Holy Spirit to just overflow and pour over this place. And this weekend, not even 2 days after I sent her the message, the whole message is on, our hearts need to break for what breaks God's heart. And that was their message. And that's God speaking to us. Our hearts need to break for what breaks His. So let's just worship this morning. Let's just pour out our hearts to Him. If you came in here with something today, do not leave with it. Leave it right here. If it's got to be right here on your face at the altar, leave it here, because it's time to allow the Holy Spirit to fill you and allow Him to move in this place and allow Him to use you and work through you and allow Him to bless you, yes, most amen. Of all. Amen.
Yes, amen. Amen. Father God, I thank You for this time, for this place, and for what You're going to do in us today, Lord. God, we need You in our lives. We need Your healing. We need Your forgiveness. We need what You have for us. We need Your strength. And we thank You, God, for loving us so desperately that You would die for us, that You would shed Your sinless blood for me. Thank You, God. Help us, Lord, to sing Your praises this morning. Receive them, Lord. Be blessed by them this morning, Lord, as we sing and open up our hearts and our mouths and we sing praises to You, God, because You deserve more than we could ever give You, Lord. Thank You for what You're doing in us, through us, and with us. In Jesus' holy name, I pray and thank You. Amen. Amen.
Wandering into the night, wanting a place to hide this weary soul, this vagabond. And I try with all my might, but I just can't win this fight. I'm slowly drifting. And just when I ran out of that road, I met a man I didn't know, and he told me that I am not alone. He picked me up, he turned me around, he placed my choice but to believe. My doubts are burning like ashes in the wind. So long to my old friends, burden and bitterness, you just keep them moving. Nah, you ain't welcome here. Streets of gold, I'll see. soul. This wayward son has found his way back home. He picked me up, he turned me around, he placed my feet on a solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because he healed my heart, he changed my
stand against, and I choose. know, there are a lot of hearts that are heavy today. A lot of pain, a lot of emotions that we're trying to deal with. Stress, anxiety, hurt, loneliness. But you know, that song just said that in the middle of that, I'm going to praise Him. That's our secret, people. Not feeling sorry for myself and feeling bad because I feel so bad, but praising Him in the middle of it. That is the answer. You've got to know that. That's our answer. That is our battlefield, is being able to praise Him when we're hurting, when things aren't going our way, when we're troubled, when we're lonely. That's our secret. So if you want it to change, that's the way you do it. You begin to praise Him and thank Him for all the goodness in your life. And not concentrate on the bad and the lonely and the hurt. Concentrate on who He is and how He wants to lift us up and change the way that we feel. Because the world is watching you. The world that doesn't know Jesus watches me. That's frightening in a way. To know that the world that needs Jesus is looking at me, who says I know Him. So why? Why would I be downhearted? Why would I be blue and feeling sorry for Jan? When the God of the universe has done what He's done for me. Let God bless you through your praise. Sacrifice of praise. Paul called it. It's the sacrifice of praise. When I don't feel like it, when I don't want to do it, whenever it hurts, do it anyway, because you'll be stronger. You'll be able to live a life that the world can see and say, yeah, I want that. I want what she's got. I want what he's got. Let's do it, people. God is counting on us to do it. The world is counting on us to do it.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Sing that again. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you. You, Lord, who came to save the heart and soul of every man. And it is you, Lord, who knows my weakness, who gives me strength. Sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lead me on, Lord, from temptation.
Can we go back to that
verse that we need to repeat. Lead me on, Lord, from temptation. Purify me from within. Fill my heart with your Holy Spirit and take away all my sin. Lord, prepare me, sanctuary. Voices, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary. Sanctuary for you, sanctuary for you.
Ending, if you would, just for a minute, because I'm going to do something rude to you and to those that are online this morning so I can do something bold for Jesus. We have a symbol of what Jesus did for us. And I don't know about you, but sometimes we're pretty thick-minded people and we get our eyes focused in the right place. So this morning, as we go to prayer, I want you to fix your eyes on that cross. Because as we sing, Lord, prepare me to be your sanctuary, we can't do it without keeping our eyes on the one who finished the work for us. So, Heavenly Father, we are so thankful. We are so thankful that you saw fit to come down to this earth, to walk among your people, Lord, the very people that you created. Not just in those days, but in today, right here, right now, in these days when we are looking at all the wrong things. But all we need to do is look up and see the victory. See the victory that you provided. Yes, your death is so important because with that death, you took every sin of ours. And you gave us the hope of freedom. But Lord, you also give us this symbol of your resurrection. You are not on the cross any longer. You are not in the tomb any longer. You are alive and well and preparing a place for us. Help us, Lord. Help us be open to be your sanctuary, to allow your presence to dwell deep within our hearts and our lives, to be who you've called us to be, to listen as you lead and direct, and to allow your Holy Spirit to do his work. Keep our eyes where they need to be. We thank you and we praise you in your great plan, Lord, that we couldn't even think of, where we try as we might to do what we can, you've already done it. You've told us it's finished. Help us to live in that truth, to accept that truth that in all of our striving and trying to look to the things of the world to satisfy us, we will always fall short, but not with your Holy Spirit guiding us, not with your Holy Spirit living in us, not with the promised of the truth living in us. So, Lord, we thank you today. We praise you today. We ask that as we hear your word, Lord, as we extend our minds to understand that it's not just about us getting, Lord, we spend too much time wanting. We need to give to you. So let us start now. Let us give us your attention and our minds and our love and our ears to hear what you have to say through your servant today. And we ask all this in Jesus' powerful, powerful name. Amen.
Amen.
Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work.
Amen. Amen. So, opening video, scripture. That scripture comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 8. I want you to keep that in your brain. I want you to keep thinking of 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 8. God loves a cheerful giver as we talk through today, okay? I really want you to keep that as the main thought of the message. I will say it again, but I'm not going to focus on it, just so you're aware. See, I heard this past weekend, and it stuck with me. It's something that I've thought for years. I've probably even said some of it here, but I don't even know which speaker said it. But I was at our district advance Friday and Saturday, and all I can tell you is they put so much into about 14 to 18 hours of time together that it just all runs together, and there was a lot of really great stuff, okay? But here's the thing. We were challenged. They said, I don't remember which speaker, but one of them was in a pulpit, and he said, listen, I get a word from God. I share that word with you. I put it out there. It's my job to send what God gives me to you. But it's your job to receive it. So you have to receive it the way you will receive it. And that's why I want you to keep that verse in your head. Receive what God has for you today. Not what I say. Not what I share. Not anything that comes from my mouth, but what God has for you today. Okay? Let me just say a really quick prayer. I know shouldn't ever say a quick prayer, but this is a quick prayer because I just feel like I need to get my mind connected with what God's saying. Okay? Lord Jesus, lead me now. I'm here to be used as your vessel. Whatever you choose to say, whatever you choose to do through me in this next few minutes, I pray that it would be received as you want it received. So hide me, Lord, in your shadow, the shadow of your cross, that my words would not ever get out, but that your words would hit right where they need to be, that you would be glorified. We come to glorify you. Prepare us to be your sanctuary, to be used for whatever you choose right now, in this day. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So today is a great day for us to consider how God blesses us as a church. It's a day that I want to take a little time to share some of the dreams your leaders have been dreaming. I told the first service, and some of you, there's probably a few more of you in here than were there that know me this way, but like, I am a dreamer. I live in vision. I don't live very well with my feet on the ground. But God is wise. If you didn't know that, God is full of wisdom. He gave me a wife who holds me down, right? She brings me back. She's like, dude, you're in the cloud. Come on down, right? Right? And it's a blessing because I'll get way out there thinking about looking at where we're going to be in 10 years. I even have an idea how I'm going to get everybody there in 10 years. I probably can't tell you how I'm going to get you there in 10 years, but in my vision, man, we're there and it's going. And Barb's like, okay, dude, come on down here. We're going to work this out so that we have a plan to make this happen, right? Our leaders have been dreaming. And so I want you to understand these are dreams, these are thoughts, these are plans in the making. Nothing is in concrete. Nothing has been decided, just ideas. So today is a day when we begin to look into the future and consider what God is saying as we pray, as we share, as we listen for His direction. That's really what it's about. We want to go where God says to go. We want to follow where He tells us to follow. We want to be where He sends us, right? Right. So today is a great day that I expect will result in good conversations about the direction of CCNaz as we move into the new day. We here at Spring Hill Calvary Church of the Nazarene, CCNaz, Cobblestone Drive, Spring Hill, right? We are here. We are here with a purpose. And we need a united vision as we move into our new day. Let me start by sharing a thought or two that comes from my personal life. See, here's my thinking. I'm thinking that if you know why I believe what I'm about to say, then you may find it easier understand. If you know why I'm saying what I am about to say, you'll probably connect better and find that place for yourself where you think God's taking us. Because we go collectively as a body, right? Okay, so if that happens, maybe, I believe, not maybe, but I believe you will join me in supporting this initiative that we've been talking about to reach our one. Well, who's our one? Our one is our neighbors, those who are currently not walking with Jesus wherever they are, right? Those who God puts on our heart to share truth, to love in the name of Jesus. Remember, you won't save anyone. Only Jesus saves. But your job, your commission, we've all been commissioned as followers of Christ, your commission is to live His life out so that others will see Jesus living in you and be drawn to Him. That's our vision. That's our vision, that everybody in this church will do everything they can to come alongside those who are not currently walking with Jesus so that he can see them, so that they can see him, so that lives can be transformed, empowered, and forever changed. Right? Hallelujah. You guys are getting it. I love it. I love it. See, I recently had a conversation with someone that I'm really just getting to know. I don't know this person very well. They've attended this church a few times, and it just kind of happened that we ended up in the same place. Had this conversation going, and the person really fed into my life, right? They spoke into my life. They talked about ways that I can improve in just in the way I live. They talked about ways I can improve in my work. They talked about ways I can improve my vision. Again, I'm not sure I need help with improving the vision. Maybe bringing it down a level, but I don't know. It was almost like having my own personal life coach. It was good. It was a good conversation. I am not complaining about this conversation at all. But the other side of the conversation had to do with the gifts that God's given me. See, this is always wonderful, and if you've ever had this, you know what I'm talking about. This person started affirming the call that they saw of God on my life. They spoke of how they sensed a desire for me to connect with the younger generation. If you don't know this, I was a youth pastor for 23 years. I had no intention of ever being anything but a youth pastor. I loved working with students. I very much enjoyed what I did, where I went, how I did things. And then God started turning on me. And I went, whoa, God, you can't change that call. And he said, wait, do I need to remind you who I am? Right? And I got to tell you, I love being a lead pastor. I love preaching. It was an interesting thing because I was just being a youth pastor. And our district superintendent called me up one day and said, hey, I really need pulpit supply over here, and you live close. I want you to go do it. And I went, no, I'm a youth pastor. And he said, no, you're an ordained elder in the Church of the Nazarene. You preach. And I said, yeah, that's true. But my pastor probably won't let me go. Don't worry about that. I'll take care of it, he said. Right? And so I went to this church. It was a small church. I don't know, 70-ish, you know, not super small, not super big, just 70-ish. And I started preaching, and I have never lost the bug. Like, I love to preach. I let other people preach. I enjoy pouring into other people, but I love to preach. God called, right? This person started talking about this confirmation that I just have a way, he said, of reaching younger ears. They also talked about the fact that when they've been here, they've heard me speak to people my age and older, and that works too. So it was, again, just an affirmation of who I am as a follower of Jesus, right? They also shared an opinion. Don't you love it when people share an opinion? But it was good. Again, all positive, shared an opinion of how I could increase my life work, how I could increase my vision. And this person left me feeling like I had been with a really great counselor. I mean, I left there feeling like, okay, this is good advice. I should begin to live this way. But they also asked me if I would pursue the gifts that God was giving me, right? We have gifts. Do you know that? All of us possess gifts. Holy Spirit gives us gifts. When we follow Christ, the gifts of God come on us. And we are to live in those. They are how we bless others. I felt so encouraged as I felt the challenges of God giving me ways to improve the way I fulfill his call on my life. It was just a good time. And the conversation reminded me of a time when I was struggling with God. You ever struggle with God? I mean, I was struggling with God over my call to become a pastor. So that tells you it was a few years ago. You see, when I became a believer, I was hesitant to give my all. If you don't know me very well, if you're new here, I want you to know this pastor is transparent. I don't hold things that God shows me. I share them because I believe God called me for a reason, and that was so that every person could see how God can work in every person, right? And I have a past that wasn't great, but I know God worked it all out. And he saved me, and that's why every time I sing a song that says, I'm free, I want you to know, hell lost another one when I was set free. Absolutely. Absolutely. The band actually pushed back a little bit. They were like, I don't know, Pastor. Hell lost another one. Do we want to say that? I'm like, yes. Yes. We want to say that because that's what this initiative is about. Saving everybody out of hell. We need to get everybody on the same vision. Let's go win them. Let's bring them in. Let's let them see this love that's transformed us. Right? See, when I became a believer, I was hesitant to give my all. I found it hard to turn all of my desires, all of my plans, all of my finances over to God. I struggled. I had great ambition. I was going to travel the world. I was going to enjoy all kinds of great toys. Anybody? No, don't raise your hand about this, but you know what I mean about having good toys? Guys especially, things that go fast, right? Right, yeah, okay. See, it wasn't that I didn't care what God wanted. And it wasn't that I didn't want to follow his will for my life. It wasn't that at all. It wasn't even that I didn't want to be who he was asking me to become. My hesitation was a question. A question. It's actually two questions. The first one made a lot of sense, and the second one goes well with it. What if he asked me to do something I didn't want to do? What? What if he asked me to do something I didn't want to do? Or go somewhere I didn't want to go? Again, if you know me, if it's cold or has that white fluffy stuff in it, I want nothing to do with it, right? Like cold, I'm talking anything under the degree of about 50. I like 50 in January, right around Christmas time, it can even go to 49 and I'm okay, right? But like the day after Christmas, 80's great, I love hot, I'm here because God loves me. He gave me paradise. Praise God, thank you for Florida, right? That's who I am. So what if he wants me to go somewhere that I don't want to go? Think about it. The perception is, when you're coming to question about who God is and what he's calling you for, the perception is sometimes he asks people to live in poverty. Sometimes he asks people to minister to the sick. Think of Mother Teresa, right? How many, again, don't raise your hand. How many of you have thought about, man, you know, when I gave my life to Christ, I hope he calls me to go work with the really sick, poor people, right? That's not what we think. Sometimes he asks us to go into the inner city where crime is rampant and people are constantly being robbed, raped, or killed. In the 60s, a guy named David Wilkerson, some of you know who that is, he was called to inner city ministry to go work with gangs. Think of that. I mean, when I gave my life to Christ, I had young kids. I was like, God, you can't ask me to go work with the gangs. I would love to go do that, but you gave me a family first, right? So, like, sometimes he asks people to give up their families and to travel all over the place sharing the gospel wherever a church or a friend or a pastor may schedule a revival. Remember those? Right? Any evangelist that you can think of, that's their life. I remember they used to come to our church at least twice a year. We would have an evangelist. We would have a revival service set. Usually it was at least 5 days, often seven, sometimes 10, right? And I would talk to the evangelist. I got to know the evangelist. We were in a pretty small church. And I would say, man, so how long are you out? 287 days this year, 298 days this year. Like, what? When do you see your family? Oh, I talk to them every night. Think about that. Sometimes he asks people to give more money than they can give, at least without giving up the things they want, right? Remember those toys I was talking about? Sometimes. And the truth is, every true believer who is listening to God has struggled with that question. How much? Really, God? I only have $20 in my pocket, and that's all I have until the end of the month. And God says, give it. But God, it's only the third. Well, that's all right. You'll survive. But I won't have anything to stop at the store and buy a soda with. I won't have anything to get a snack with. I'm going to be hungry, God. Just give the $20, Ed. And I reach in my pocket and I pull out $20 and there's $22. I say, oh, I can keep the two. God says, put it in there. Right? Right? You can relate. If you've been walking in this life at all, you know what I'm talking about. So I struggled to give it all. And maybe if you understand that, maybe you understand a little bit why I'm always quoting Romans 12, 1 and 2. Right? Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. I could stop right there. It says, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. When I came to the point of becoming a living sacrifice, giving all of myself to God and allowing him to lead every part of my life, he changed my fear of him asking too much of me to a love for him that allows me to do everything he asks, as well as everything I can think of for him. Now, what does that mean? That means I want him to be pleased with me, right? Some of you have parents. My guess is most, right? It's kind of a requirement to be here. I love my parents. There's nothing that I would not do to help them out, right? God, I love God so much that there's nothing that I want to hold back from him. What I mean is that his love transformed me and gave me the ability to do more for him. And why? Because I love him. And I'm grateful that he filled me with life. Life. This isn't the guy that you would have known when I was 17, 18, 20 years old. This isn't the guy. See, he gave me a life that's full of his joy. His joy. It's his love that now allows me to do more. He allows me to be more. He allows me to give more. Why? Because I love him. That's the true origin of my call. And that's the true motivation of my desire to reach those who are not yet walking with Jesus. There are many who want to know what it's like to live in peace instead of finding their lives full of turmoil. Many people out there who are living in turmoil and really want, really have a desire to know the peace of God. There are many who want to know what it's like to have inner joy. You know, that joy that we can't really talk about, we really can't explain it. It's just in there and it comes out. I like it when my joy like spills on somebody that's not very happy. Right? That kind of joy that I can't contain. There's people who want to understand what that joy is. And it constantly keeping God in their lives, keeping them strong when everything seems to be falling apart. Right? There are many who want to know what it's like to feel loved. To feel loved, especially when that love doesn't come with conditions. Can you imagine that? A love that's not got any conditions. I mean, I love you because you're part of my life. I love you because you're good. I love you because you support or you help. Those are not needed. Just love. That kind of love. That kind of love causes people to want to please the source of the love that they receive. Right? Amen. I'd also say, now that I've experienced these things, that my original fears, that God would ask too much of me, they were completely unprecedented and unrealistic. They just were. Everything that He's asked me to do has resulted in blessing. It's resulted in growth. It's resulted in an exceeding amount of unconditional love. So, let me give you some information about how we want to prepare our place, our house, to receive the people we believe God is going to bring into this place to worship with us. If you attended one of the vision gatherings over the last 2 weeks, you heard a lot more details than I'm about to give, okay? But I want everyone in our church to know what we are thinking about as we move forward. So here's just a list of brainstormed ideas, projects, and plans, okay? First of all, we know we need to do some landscaping. If you've ever noticed, this church, it just needs some good landscaping around. We want to do a sanctuary upgrade. Everything in here just needs to be upgraded. We want to do some work on the stage, change some things around, make some changes. We want to improve our projection. If you're like me, I don't care where I sit, every word on that screen looks fuzzy. We need to clear it up, right? We need to fix that. We need to fix our sound so that it's good everywhere, not just loud one place and quiet in another. But just fix it. We need to do some work on our floor. Now, don't anybody look down. I know all of you want to look down right now. But there's some things about the floor, some stains, some issues that we need to get resolved. We have a computer, at least one computer that has to be replaced soon. We have three, count them, 1, 2, 3 air conditioners that are on their last leg. That comes from 3 different air conditioning companies. Tell us, well, I can get it to work, but I'm not sure how long. We want to do some work in our foyer area just to dress it up and make it a little better, make it a little more welcoming. You see, your leadership team is preparing to make these improvements, and we're all praying that God will supply the funds needed to accomplish them without taking any loans. We don't want to go back in debt. Nobody wants to go back in debt. We paid this place off, right? You can celebrate that, I allow you. That was a big, big deal. But we know that when we start a project, we will need to finish it. So, if we really have to, we will come to you as the members and say, here's our plan, here's our idea, what do you think? Because you have to approve before we can get a loan. Okay? So, we need to do some work. And we know that God has given us vision, some of us more than others. And we know that we need funds to cover all that. We are hoping that those funds will all be here and nothing will have to be on loan. And we know that if we do have to get even a short construction loan, that we're going to pay it off before we do anything else, right? Anybody here remember $130,000 debt just a couple years ago? Right, right. We don't want that. Never again. See, we want to make sure that we're ready when God starts bringing these people that we're all going to start walking with into our services. I've found that every time the Lord shows me a need, He also shows me His plan on how it will be accomplished. Every time. I remember well the projects that I used to do. I used to lead a youth ministry. I was a youth pastor for 23 years, and so I led mission trips almost every year. On those trips, we did things like we built education rooms for adults and children. We poured a cement floor for a new sanctuary. We painted the whole inside of a house that was being transformed into a youth center for a church. I mean, we did a lot of projects on these trips. I just got a side note I have to share because I didn't share it with the first service. But when we were preparing to paint that house, the pastor's wife was with us, and she decided to take it on herself to clean the paint off of the receptacles after the kids painted. So she had a bucket of water and a rag, and she would dip the rag in the bucket, get it wet, bring it out, and then try to get the paint off. And I walked into the room, and I see her, and she's going, oh, oh. I'm like, Carol, what are you doing? I'm cleaning the paint off of these. I'm like, Carol, that's live. I know. I keep getting zapped. So I went and turned off the breaker, and she was able to finish the job. Right? See, we were dedicated to get our work done. Okay. I'm sorry, that was completely not necessary. But we did a lot of projects on those trips. And in every project, in every place we ever went, God supplied what was needed for them to be accomplished. In every trip. As a matter of fact, at the end of every trip, I handed the leader that we were working with there on site an envelope full of money and said, God blessed us with more than we needed, so here. Buy something you need for whatever it is you're doing. Every time, God is abundant. He shares. This is why I feel sure that when we listen to what God is asking us to do, we truly work as one unified body of believers who wants to see the community around us come to know the love of God and walk in His way. If we will do that, He will supply all that is needed to make it happen. Maybe you've heard this saying, you can't outgive God. I've found that statement to be 100% true all of the time. But it will take all of us truly listening and following God's lead for these things to happen. In the 15th chapter of Deuteronomy, the writer is explaining that every 7 years, the Israelites were to forgive or release the debt that they were carrying against their fellow Israelites. When they followed this plan, God's plan. He blessed their economy, and he kept them focused on the vision that he had given them to prosper and grow as a nation. Verse 10 says this: give generously to him, and do so without a grudging heart. Then, because of this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in everything you put your hand to. This is a key to finding the blessing God wants to pour out on his people. We should never complain or begrudge anyone when we give. God wants us to give with a cheerful heart. Remember that lady that looked like Jessica, that wasn't Jessica, reading that verse, 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 8? It says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your hearts to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. When we realize Holy Spirit is guiding us to put our finances in his hands, and we take our personal wants out of the equation, he begins to use us, and he begins to use what we give to bless others and to bless his church. And this always turns into his blessing over you and over me as he gives back more than we ever expect. Luke 6:38 says, give and it will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Now think about that. Anybody here ever do any baking? A couple of you, okay. So you know when you get out that cup, that measuring cup, and you put your brown sugar in there, like I'm good at getting the brown sugar and dumping it in. Barb's like, no, 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 that's not how you do it. Get the brown sugar, put it on the counter, push it down. Work it in, shake it in, get it in there. Then you have the right amount, right? Pressed down, shaken together, moved. You get a lot more brown sugar that way, right? When we give to projects that are supporting and building the kingdom of God, we can expect his blessing on our life and our church. We can expect his blessing on our personal finances as well. And we can expect his blessing on all our family. You see, that's what it means when it says household, that he'll bless our household. He'll bless our family. God holds true to his promises. And every time I've given, even when I've given more than I should have given, I do that sometimes. You ever heard of give until it hurts, right? I've done that. And every time he, God, has blessed my life, he's blessed my finances, and he's blessed my household, my family. This brings me to the next step. The next step is found in your blue card. If you look on the back of your blue card, you'll see a 1, 2, 3. Right above that, it says, my next step is to listen as God directs me to bless others and the church through my generous giving. This may be the first time I've ever been this bold in asking people to consider how their money affects their daily walk with Jesus from the pulpit. I mean, I talk to people about it all the time, but in the pulpit, I don't go there very often. I've been chastised by some of you and by God for that at times, right? But I'm just not a preacher who talks about money very often. But I know that our finances, our money, can quickly become a stumbling block for our faith. You see, I was just at General District Assembly, and at District Assembly, they pass a bucket. And Barb and I very seldom ever have cash, and we didn't have cash, so Barb grabbed her phone, and there's a giving way to give, and so she pulled it out, and she said, I need the card, and I gave her the card, and she gave, right? Well, then, last night at our ordination service, we always take up an offering for the retiring pastors. And she's important, so she was on the stage. That's not true, but she was on the stage. And she was being used for some things. She was reading some stuff. And anyway, so they passed the bucket, and I got out my app, and I gave electronically. Well, just as I was pushing go, Barb sat down. And she said, oh, you're giving again? Yeah. Yeah, one day we're going to retire, right? So, yeah, I did. And she said, okay, we better pray, right? Because you give because the Spirit prompts you to give. And so you give. And he'll work it out. And we've lived our lives that way for a lot more than 40 years, so we're going to keep on going, right? See, I know that when I made the choice to keep God more important in my life than my money, I saw his blessing on my life increase tremendously. Tremendously. There is only one place that I can find in Scripture, in the whole of the Bible, that encourages us to test God. And it has to do with our finances. It's found in Malachi chapter 3. If you'd like to look at that, it's in verse 10. It says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to store it. What? See, that's a powerful way to tell people who follow you to test you, right? And I, for one, can stand here and say, I have tested God in this, and he has kept his promises. So as the team comes back to the front to lead us, I have one more thought. It's kind of long. They'll be there a long time. Don't worry about them. We're talking about how important it is for us to come alongside those who are not currently walking with Jesus. We've been praying that God would give us opportunities to share his love with them, right? To show them how much he loves them through the way we love them. We're building toward the idea that we should have one vision, and it should be to do all we can to serve our neighbors so that they will enter into a relationship with our Savior. So now, I ask, will you step up and support your church? Your church, will you support as we prepare the house of the Lord to receive your new friends, my new friends, right? The visitors that are going to come, all of us who come together to connect and become a part of this wonderful CCNaz family. God says to test him and see what he will do when you and I put him first and give him the glory for the things that are brought into the storehouse. By the way, the storehouse is the place where you receive the Word of God, your church. Will you begin to pray and ask him to show you how you can help us reach our goal? As you leave here today, this is a replica of what you will receive, okay? There's going to be one of these that you get as you leave if you want it. Then nobody's going to force you to take it. But it is just a commitment card where you can write the name of the person or people that you're intentionally going to reach out to. You're going to begin to walk with. There's also a spot on there where you can give an amount of money that you want to pledge. See, on May 5th, that's Commitment Sunday, May 5th, we're going to make a big deal about asking everyone to fill out a commitment card. And so I'm asking that you'll take this, keep it in your Bible or on your table or wherever it is you do your devotions, and just pray and ask God what He wants you to do. Who's He going to bring into your life? Who does He have you going to be intentionally reaching out to, walking alongside, right? If when you're praying, you don't figure out who you're going to be praying, who you're going to be walking with, who you're going to be working with intentionally, if you're all in, then I'm going to ask you to just put a question mark there. That means that you're in. You just don't know who it is yet. And God will bring that person or people to you. There's no doubt. If you don't want to share a name, you can put initials or one initial, you know. I don't care. You can just write Ed, and then everybody will think it's somebody else, but it's probably me. Okay? Does that work? Let's just make it easy. The point is, I want you to seriously pray over this and what God is going to ask you to do. Chrissy Shields is our treasurer, and she shared with our board just a couple meetings ago that we can actually reach our goal if all of the giving units in this church were to give $100 more than you give now per month, which breaks down to about $25 a week. Sounds like something that we could actually do. Not everybody, though, right? Some of us are right at the edge. We can't really give any more than we give. That's understandable. But some of you could give $400 or $500 a week or a month, right? So the point is, as it works, in 2 years, we should be able to reach our goal with no trouble. The only other thing I want to say to that is on the 19th of May, Pentecost Sunday, in case you are not used to this church, we celebrate on Pentecost Sunday. We celebrate the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the beginning of the church. We get excited about what God does. And we're going to celebrate what God's doing in this initiative on that day. So even if you're visiting and you're thinking, I'm never coming back to this church, come on that day. We're going to have some food. We're going to have some fun. It's going to be an exciting day. Just come. But if you do come and you feel like God's prompting you to give, we're going to ask that you bring your first offering that day. And we're going to make a big deal about that too, so that you can come and give publicly. This is what God's doing. We know God is doing amazing things. And we know that God has a special gift for us as we continue to follow Him. So, will you stand with me and sing along with the band as we're prompted to do it again? Because God is going to do it again.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. Your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I've seen
never fails, and he will never fail us. He'll never fail you. As the sign out front says, we have one chance. Will you go for it? I'm an 80s boy. Go for it was one of the sayings we said all the time, right? Go for it. I know we're following God's lead in this. So I believe it's time for us to go for it and expect that he will bring the increase as we live our lives for him. Now, go from this place and be the Jesus people need to see. Go in his peace.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in.